Good afternoon. Details of an historic defence deal have been unveiled today. A submarine program costing up to $368 billion over the next three decades. Australia to build a new fleet of eight nuclear-powered submarines in Adelaide using a British design. Those are expected to begin service in the 2040s. And from the early 2030s, we'll buy at least three US Virginia-class subs as part of the AUKUS alliance with the US and UK.
We're putting ourselves in the strongest possible position to navigate the challenges of today and tomorrow together.
We are bound above all by our belief in a world where the sovereignty of every nation is respected and the inherent dignity of every individual is upheld.
Russia's illegal invasion of Ukraine, China's growing assertiveness, the destabilizing behavior of Iran and North Korea, all threaten to create a world defined by danger, disorder, and division. Faced with this new reality, it is more important than ever that we strengthen the resilience of our own countries.
The US president has stressed the submarines are nuclear-powered, not nuclear-armed. Australia is reacting to this historic pact. Let's bring in federal politics reporter Fiona Willen in Canberra. Fee, today both sides of politics are celebrating this deal.
Well, Mark, both sides have pointed out this is one of the biggest deals in Australia's history, and they agree that it's a crucial move to protect the region. But the opposition has also raised questions over the cost. So the initial hit will appear in the May budget. That's $9 billion over 4 years. And by the 2050s, the price tag is estimated to reach up to $368 billion. So that's when the fleet of eight submarines is expected to be finished. Now, the Greens have suggested this will lead to cuts in health, education and housing, while the coalition is demanding to know where the money will come from. Now, Richard Marles has acknowledged the price is significant, but says we can't afford not to do this, pointing to growing instability in the region.
We need to respond to this. A failure to do so would see us be condemned by history.
We have to make sure that there is transparency and honesty with the Australian people about the cost involved in AUKUS.
Now, despite these calls for further details, the opposition says it will support the AUKUS deal come hell or high water. Now, of course, also pointing out this plan was hatched under Scott Morrison. Not everyone is feeling supportive, though, which is why government ministers have launched a major diplomatic campaign, making more than 60 calls to world leaders in recent days. Now, the aim is to keep them in the loop, but also ease nerves where necessary. One country that hasn't accepted the invitation for a briefing yet is China. Beijing has already made it clear it's not happy about the plan. We spoke with a defence expert about it.
We have spoken loudly with a fairly small stick. We need to speak more softly and with a bigger stick.
This sends a clear message that if you want to do harm to Australians, you're going to get a bloody nose.
Now, questions have also been raised about where the nuclear waste from these submarines will go. And today the government has confirmed it's made a commitment to dispose of it on defence land. It'll announce further details of how a site will be selected within the next year. Mark?
Fiona Willen in Canberra, thank you. Large numbers of people were evacuated last night as an out-of-control electrical fire tore through a business in Sydney's inner west. Alex Heinke has the details.
Well, an electrical fault is being blamed for causing a huge fire that's torn through an electrical supplies business here in Homebush. Some 20 residents were evacuated from nine nearby properties at about 10:30 last night when these flames really did take hold. You can have a look at some of this vision actually captured from neighbours that were evacuated. You can see the flames rising some 10 to 15 metres above the building here on Parramatta Road. Firefighters took several hours to get it under control, and there was really a huge threat from toxic smoke.
The fire was venting, high flames coming through the front windows. They got to work and they started to use ladder trucks where they got one to put the water on the fire with another one starting to lift the roof sheeting so they could also get in and attack that fire.
Well, fire investigators are actually on scene right now. At this stage, it's not being treated as suspicious, and the good news is that no one was injured.
In 11 days' time, we head to the polls to vote in the New South Wales state election. Two men are battling to be Premier, the man who currently holds the job, Dominic Perrottet, and Labor leader Chris Minns. And tomorrow, both of them will be put through their paces by a host of Nine political experts. Two of them join me now, Nine's Peter Overton and state politics reporter Liz Daniels. We'll be watching at 12 p.m. tomorrow. What can we expect?
Good afternoon, Mark. Well, this is Studio A at Nine's headquarters in North Sydney, and this is where the debate will be held between Premier Dominic Perrottet and the opposition leader Chris Minns. And with me is Liz Daniels, our state political editor here on Nine News. Liz, we've got a great panel. Tell us all about it.
A panel of journalists from across the Nine family, Peter, will be questioning the leaders. I'll be in the chair alongside our 2GB Drive host Chris O'Keefe and the Sydney Morning Herald's state political editor Alexandra Smith. And we'll be tossing our questions across the floor to the leaders. Let's go and have a feel of what they will be feeling on the day tomorrow. Pete, you're in the red corner. That's where Chris Minns will stand. And this is where the Premier Dominic Perrottet will be taking questions, and they're nice and close, you can see. Let's hope they come with their boxing gloves on.
Indeed, we need a bit of energy, I think. They've been very respectful of each other throughout this whole campaign. I've asked them both, do you like Dominic Perrottet? Do you like Chris Minns? And they both say, yeah, he's a good bloke, he's a good bloke. But they each want the job, the top job, obviously. So hot button issues that affect the community. What are they? Well, of course, cost of living, housing, affordable housing, the rent crisis, education, wages, all those things that people are talking about and being affected by will be discussed by the panel.
That's right. We've got some tough questions to answer and let's hope we get some answers. You'll be moderating and let's see, hopefully they come with a bit of energy and some trading some blows right here.
I hope so. And it's all at 12 noon tomorrow, Mark, right here on Nine. Simulcast, of course, on 2GB radio, and you can watch it on the Sydney Morning Herald website as well. See you tomorrow, Mark.
More than 100 people have been killed and dozens injured in one of the strongest cyclones ever recorded. Cyclone Freddy slammed into southern Africa for a second time in a month, causing devastation across Malawi and Mozambique. Meteorologists have tipped the cyclone as potentially the longest-lasting tropical storm in history. A wet and grey afternoon across much of Sydney. It's 22 degrees on the harbour right now, 22 also at the airport and 21 at Olympic Park. The sun should return to Sydney tomorrow with a top of 29 degrees. It'll be cloudy and 32 degrees in Brisbane, 29 the top in Canberra, overcast in Melbourne, the chance of a shower in Hobart, sunny and 29 in Adelaide, warm in Perth and storms and 31 in Darwin. Working the land is a tough game, especially when dealing with the natural disasters our state has been hit with in the last few years. So this is a big win for farms, especially those along the Murray River and in the state's far north. The federal government securing a deal to export our avocados to India. Avocados Australia's CEO John Tyas joins me for more. John, thank you for your time. What does this mean for the Australian avocado industry?
Yeah, this is great news for our industry. We've seen significant production increases over the last few years right around the country. And, you know, the industry's really needs to develop more export markets. At the moment, most of our fruit goes to open markets like Singapore, Malaysia and Hong Kong. But access to India gives us a potential access to a really large market that we think we can grow and develop in the coming years.
John, some people might be surprised to hear many Australian avocados are actually grown here in New South Wales. What will our farmers get with this deal?
Yeah, well, the beauty of this protocol is that it's available for all growers and packers around Australia, whereas other protocols that we've got, say, for Western Australia to Japan, it's only certain regions of the country. So this will allow all growers in all regions to access this market. Obviously, there's a lot of work that needs to be done before that can happen. There's 10 trial shipments that need to occur and be successful. And then there's a lot of training and accreditation of growers and pack houses to access the market. But we think that it is a market that we can really grow and develop and be a major player. We produce year-round supply of avocados because we grow in so many different regions, including New South Wales. And we're also in a really great position with our proximity to India compared with our competitors such as New Zealand and South American countries.
India is a huge country, population around about 1.4 billion. How big is the market there for avocados?
Yeah, so at the moment it's quite small, but it's been growing rapidly. It's doubled every year for the past few years. India actually grows avocados themselves, but most of the avocados they grow are what we call a green skin variety, and they're used mainly in drinks. So our Hass avocados are really a fairly different product from what they consume domestically. But there's definitely a very solid market for avocados, particularly in the top-end retail sector. I went over there a few years ago and I was really impressed with how sophisticated their top-end retailing is and their merchandising and their understanding of the product. So I think it's a market that is set to grow.
And John, just quickly, if I go into my local supermarket and I can't get my avocados because they've all gone to India, that's not going to happen, is it?
No. Australia is still our main market. Most of our avocados are sold here in Australia. It's, you know, it's one of the best avocado markets in the world, and will continue to be. And we're keen to continue to grow consumption in Australia as well. But we do need to develop these new export markets, given the rapidly increasing production volumes that are going to come online in the coming years.